Hello and good morning to you. Today is the second Sunday of Easter. It's the 24th of April, and this service is coming to you from St. Paul's Anglican Church in Parkhurst, Johannesburg. This recording will take into account the gospel reading for today on which the sermon is based and the sermon itself. But let me just give you the other readings for today in case you don't have those. So the readings are Acts 5:27 to 32, or Job 42, 1 to 6. The psalm is Psalm 118, verses 14 to 29. The New Testament reading is Revelation 1, verses 4 to 8. And the gospel is John 20, verses 19 to 31. Now I'm going to ask Mike to come forward and read the gospel for us this morning.
Listen to the good news proclaimed in the Gospel according to St. John, chapter 20, verses 19 to 31.
Glory to Christ our Saviour.
Jesus appears to his disciples. On the evening of that first day of the week, when the disciples were together, with the doors locked for fear of the Jewish leaders, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Again Jesus said, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you." And with that he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone's sins, their sins are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven." Jesus appears to Thomas. Now Thomas, also known as Didymus, was one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands, and put my finger where the nails were, and put my hand into his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here, see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe." Thomas said to him, "My Lord and my God." Then Jesus told him, "Because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." This is the gospel of Christ.
Praise to Christ our Lord. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of all our hearts be always acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our God, and our Redeemer. Amen. So I have titled this sermon, based on John chapter 20, 19 to 31, Doubting Thomas and Ourselves. You see, the unfairly titled Doubting Thomas underlines a deep yearning for God's presence in our world. Like Thomas, many in our secular age want data or legal indications of Christ's presence in the world as we know it. Just like Jesus, the world too has its pierced hands and side. We say we believe, and yet we want the kind of data or logic or legality we have come to demand about all that is going on in our world. Without that, faith in the triumph of light over darkness seems implausible, or at least out of reach. Resurrection is too magnificent a concept to grasp, or if we do grasp the fact that by Jesus' death he overcame death and sin, it's more so something we say religiously rather than actually believe. Once again, we want proof, and in this we are no different to Thomas. Indeed, apart from John, the author of this gospel, and Jesus' beloved disciple, it seems as though the disciples were locked into the same kind of tombs that we experience in our daily life. Upon seeing the empty tomb, the disciples didn't preach, they didn't join the choir, they just went home. Mary Magdalene stands outside the empty tomb, weeping, but seeing only strangers indifferent to her dilemma. Then later the disciples, perhaps the ones who went home earlier, locked themselves into a house for fear of persecution. And Thomas voices their inner feelings. He insists he will not believe until he sees the marks of crucifixion on Jesus' body. We too are filled with fear, just like the disciples, who daily awaited the same kind of fate which happened to Jesus, because as his known followers, they knew that at any moment they could be at least imprisoned and perhaps even killed. They were not heroes, at least they weren't heroes then. And then we find that Jesus appears in their midst, even though the doors to the room they were hiding in were locked. Again, logic tells us that this is difficult to believe. The sudden appearance. Jesus shows them the wounds in his hands and his side, and once again we cry out, as did Thomas, show us proof that this could happen, although we don't admit that, of course. You see, we all have walls inside us that, unlike our heart, which wants to believe, and unlike our religious experience, which has taught us all about faith being the master of what we believe, once again, our experience of the secular world asks why, if God is so powerful, why then are we still living in darkness? Even in our own country, we see an escalation of gender-based violence, of corruption, of abuse of power, of the chaos caused by floods to those who can least cope with it. And a small part of us says, where are you now, Jesus? Why are all these things happening in our world? We too want proof that God is still at work in our world and will overcome its darkness. And much of why we want this proof is based on our fear. Fear of what this world has become. Why are we experiencing this now when at the time, Jesus, in your time, you could draw thousands of people to believe in you and what you stood for as you performed your miracles and even went to the cross in order to save us? What did you save us from if we are still experiencing the horrors and terrors of this world? Or put another way, do we really have to wait until we die in order to experience heaven? Thy kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven. All of these thoughts are based on fear. Why can't we, as modern-day disciples, fully accept that Jesus is Lord in the midst of these atrocities? How many times do we ask ourselves, why God does not do something? We are supposed to have perfect understanding, and yet we can't stop these thoughts permeating our mind. And yet in the midst of all of this, I find myself remembering other words of another disciple, also called John, who said, there is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear. Or perhaps we need to look at it another way. Jesus' appearance in this context of fear amongst his disciples culminates with one of the distinctive marks of the Christian community, the practice of forgiveness. Forgiveness calls us to trust in God's power to initiate resurrection in our midst, precisely where we least expect it to be. On to Thomas. He too suffered from fear, and this led him to doubt. He said, until I see the marks of the nails in his hands and put my hands in his side, I will not believe. See, apparently Thomas believes in data-driven conclusions as well. And truth be told, so do we. Thomas speaks to our values more than we recognize. As people of faith, we experience an almost reflex-like dislike of doubting Thomas. But that's not really fair to him. For as long as so many people in this world ask, is God real or just a nice concept? Nothing has really changed. Does God exist in the midst of pain, injustice, and doubt? We would say we are people of deep faith, but in the face of the horror of the world we live in, do we too have doubts? Perhaps the answer is found in remembering that every time the disciples saw evidence of the power of God at work in Jesus, he would often tell them that the time was not right for them to go and tell others of what they had seen and discovered. Now, why is this? Well, for the believer, this is easy to understand. Isn't there a biblical instruction to not cast pearls before swine? Unless people can really accept that in the midst of all this created horror in our world, created, let's be honest, by the greed of humankind, others are not going to accept that God is still at work in places where we least expect it. And yet you know, and I know, that this is true. Even as we live out our lives in this world, we do see evidence of God's work. We do see the milk of human kindness. We do see hearts and minds changing as they come to know God through their experience of his son, Jesus, and what he did to convince the world that he was indeed real. Not only that, he alone was prepared to go to the cross, an inhumane death, and we say a death he freely accepted, so that all would have life, and life in abundance. Perhaps in Thomas, we hear the one who prays like the psalmist prays, pleading for God's existence amidst our groans, watching for God in the land parched with doubt, but no water, looking for the God who bears the marks of our weary world on his own body. Perhaps we could hear Thomas this way, as one who seeks evidence of God's presence in the world through the mark of the nails in his hands. If so, Thomas's response to Jesus suggests vastly more evidence for God's existence. On Thomas's lips, we hear the personal confession, "My Lord and my God." Thomas wanted only to see the nail marks in Jesus' hands, to put his hand into his side, but he received on his lips and within his heart was vastly more than the wounds he received. His Lord and my God.